to Kansas Avenue. It's a beautiful day. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice today and be glad in it. Amen? So we're so glad to see everybody here this morning. And just a few announcements to make as we get started. One of the main ones I want to tell you about is coming up on Saturday morning, as we will be gathering from 9 to 10 downstairs for a ministry team meeting. And that's those who want to be involved in some hands-on ministries that we're trying to get started. We believe God has led us in these areas. And so those areas are basically with your children, youth, and families. That's going to be one team. Another, outreach and evangelism. That's another. They kind of cross over. One's worship. And then the other one would be congregational care. A lot of this work is already being done. We're just trying to organize it a little bit. So if you can come, we'd love to see you. Whether you were at the meeting in February or not, this one here is going to be a little different. We're just going to meet a short time, and we're going to get hopefully some things rolling in the next few weeks. And I believe God's going to bless us and honor us as we do that. So hopefully we'll see you from 9 to 10 on Saturday morning, this coming Saturday, July the 23rd, downstairs here at Kansas Avenue. We've invited some of the friends from Oakland to come and join us as well. And then our Bible study this afternoon is on Hebrews. You're welcome to join us. We just had a few of us here of late. You're always welcome to come and sit in on that as well. And we look forward to having you here for either of those meetings coming up. Well, you know, we had camp at Camp Chippewa just the other week, a few weeks ago. One of the kids last week said she was at Camp Chickawa, not one day chicken. But Camp Chippewa was a great experience. They had so much fun, so many memories were made. But, you know, out of that meeting that came out, you guys can start walking up here as we're talking. Out of that, we found out that they did have a lot of good Bible classes and worship times in the chapel. And after our meeting last week in the downstairs for our second Sunday potluck, some of the children said they wanted to sing a song. And I asked them what that song was, and they told me. And so you guys can stay right over here. You don't need to go up there back there. Y'all can come over here. Come right in here. And so they are going to sing a song. Do you have that song queued up and ready?
The video.
That's what I'm saying. Do you have it ready? Okay. So guys, are you guys ready? You know the song. It may be a little bit different, but I think you'll be fine with it. So we're going to let them sing. This is a song from Camp Chippewa called Big House. And you crank that up all the way. Our prayer, shall we? Our dear Lord, we thank you for bringing us all here this morning on a beautiful Sunday morning that you have created. Lord, we ask you, Lord, to help us to just quiet ourselves down in your presence, to worship you, to just bask in your presence this morning, Lord, and put all of our cares and concerns aside for this hour so that you can come and have full access to our lives. Lord, we pray for those who need a special touch today, whether it's a physical, mental, spiritual, emotional touch, or maybe there are people needing work or employment. Maybe there's relationship needs out there. Lord, whatever those needs are, we know that you are well aware of them, and we ask that you would be especially close to those today who call out to you in their time of need. Lord, we thank you for being a good God, for being a gracious God, for protecting us and guiding us and getting us back out here this morning. Lord, we pray for those who aren't able to be here today, those that are in nursing facilities especially. We ask your blessing on them, help them to know that they're not forgotten, that we love them. Lord, that we are caring about them even now. Lord, be especially close to them. We ask for your presence in our greater community, in our city, our state, our nation, and around the world. We still think of those in Ukraine who are suffering through this war. We pray your blessing and peace on them as well. Now, Lord, we pray that prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we have another Psalm, page 103. I think you'll be able to stay seated for this one. Immortal, invisible, God only wise. The songs of the temple shall become wailings in that day, says the Lord God. The dead bodies shall be many, cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale?
We will make the ephah small and the shekel great and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and everyone mourn who lives in it? And all of it rise like the Nile, and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt. On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feast into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on all loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like the mourning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. Our psalm today will just be read, not through a responsive reading, but I will just read it, Psalm 52. Why do you boast, O mighty one, of mischief done against the godly? All day long you are plotting destruction. Your tongue is like a sharp razor, your worker of treachery. You love evil more than good, you and lying more than speaking the truth. You love all words that devour, O deceitful tongue. But God will break you down forever, and he will snatch and tear you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. The righteous will see and fear and will laugh at the evildoer, saying, see, the one who would not take refuge in God, but trusted in abundant riches and sought refuge in wealth. But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. I will thank you forever because of what you have done in the presence of the faithful. I will proclaim your name, for it is good. We now turn to our gospel reading today from the 10th chapter of Luke, verses 38 to 42, just five verses. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. And she had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There's need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken from her. May God add his blessing to the reading of the scripture today. We will turn now to page 70 for the hymn, Glory Be to the Father. This is going to be read after our scripture passage.
We're going to do 71. Same words. Thank you.
Thank you.
sermon is titled Before All Things, and we're going to look at a section of Colossians, but we're also going to go back into our gospel today. So I'm really looking forward to this because I think this is one we'll have a little fun with, and I believe God's got something for all of us today. Wherever we're at in our journey and our faith, I think God's got something very special today. And so let's look at Colossians chapter 1 and verses 15 to 28. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, the supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he's first in everything. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemy, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. And yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. So as a result, he has brought you into his own presence. And you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. But you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. Good news has been preached all over the world, and I, Paul, have been appointed as God's servant to proclaim it. I'm glad when I suffer for you in my body, for I am participating in the sufferings of Christ that continue for his body, the church. God has given me the responsibility of serving his church by proclaiming his entire message to you. Now, this message was kept secret for centuries and generations past. But now it has been revealed to God's people. For God wanted them to know that the riches and glory of Christ are for you, Gentiles, too. And this is the secret. Christ lives in you. This gives you assurance of sharing his glory. So we tell others about Christ, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all the wisdom God has given us. We want to present them to God perfect in their relationship to Christ. That's why I work and struggle so hard, depending on Christ's mighty power that works within me. May God add his blessing to that reading of the scripture. Well, again, the sermon title today is Before All Things. And Christ is before all things. Remember in John 1:1, it said, Jesus said that as the world was beginning to be formed, that the Word was with God, and the Word was with God. He has always been. Jesus wasn't some created being that just showed up in a Bethlehem manger. He has always existed. From before we can even imagine, our minds cannot comprehend how God could exist at a time that there was no beginning. But that's the way it is, and it's just something we'll have to hopefully find out when we get up to heaven. But in the meantime, we know that Christ is the first. He is the apex of all things, of all creation, in terms of how he brought everything into existence, and now as our Savior, he is sufficient. He did everything that needed to be done when he died on that cross for us. So we don't need to have a little bit of Jesus here and a little bit of some other teachings here and somebody else's teachings here and kind of mix it all together like we're making a tossed salad. Not that way. Jesus is sufficient. He is alone what we need. The church in Colossae, which was found in the southern part of modern-day Turkey, they were trying to mix in all these other beliefs, all these other religions, kind of like what we see today here in America. I remember when I was a kid, we'd go out to eat, and you would order something off the menu, and that was it. You got it, and that was it. And then along came all these big buffets, and you could go get everything you wanted. And man, that was a child's dream. You'd go up there, and
Remember going to the Golden Crown, the kids were little, and they would skip the meat, the potatoes, the vegetables, and go straight to the dessert bars, you know. And that's kind of how it is with us as Christians sometimes. We think we can get anything and everything we want. A little bit of Jesus here takes care of that, and then we add all these other beliefs in here. That's not the way it works. Jesus is sufficient, He alone. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, the Lord. So that's all we need. Jesus is all we need. So I'm really thankful today that we can come as Christians today, and even though things in our world keep changing and we see things constantly in upheaval, there are certain things that just remain the same. They always be that way, and that's what we find in the Word of God. The Word of God never changes. It's always the same. So in the midst of a time of great upheaval and change in our world, it's great to know that there's one thing that stays the same. That's God's Holy Bible. The Word is always going to point us to Jesus. There's never going to be a contradiction. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. We can always trust it. And I'm so thankful for that Word that doesn't change. I'm so thankful I don't wake up in the morning. I think, okay, I wonder which direction the wind is going to blow today so that I can know which way to go. I know which way to go because the Bible tells me so. Amen.
Amen.
Three takeaways from this sermon today. Instead of going at the very end, I'm going to give them to you right up front. So first of all, today we want to be aware of the fact that Jesus Christ is sufficient. First and foremost, that's our foundation, that we come to Christ through His goodness, through His grace. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it, obviously. He just loved us, and He wants a relationship with us. When God created us, He created us to be in a relationship with Him. And if we don't have that relationship, I believe there'll be something missing from our life. There's always going to be that emptiness. It's only going to be filled through Christ. And it doesn't mean anything about a religion or a denomination or a church or all the things you do or don't do. It's about your personal relationship with God. How do you get that relationship? You just believe. You have faith. You have trust. You ask Christ to come in and to save you because you couldn't save yourself. And then you develop that relationship. But it's very hard to have a relationship, isn't it, when there are obstacles in the way. In other words, if there's communication issues, it's really hard to have a good relationship. Last night we were speaking down at the rescue mission, and I went down Kansas Avenue, and just as I went down, guess what it was? That train comes down there right past the street, and I'm like, well, that's great. We'll just take the flyover. Used to be you couldn't take that flyover. You had to sit there and wait. But I looked at that this morning again in this realm. Sometimes that's how it is with our faith. Between us and God, we know where our destination is. We want to have that relationship and communication with our Lord. But things get in the way sometimes. And we're like, Lord, as soon as that train passes, then I'll be able to get over to you. But until the train passes, I've just got to take care of business right here. And it doesn't always work that way in our lives because guess what? Then another train comes. And another. There's always going to be a train coming to disrupt our relationship, if you know what I mean. I remember years ago, we used to serve dinner down there on Friday nights at a different church I was at. And one time we were, before the fly-off was over there on Curtis Street, and we would be down there, and it would be about 7 o'clock. We got everything cleaned up. We were ready to go. And all of a sudden, it seemed like without fail, there would be a train coming. And I'll remember one time, and the train just stopped right in front of us. Does that ever happen to you in your life? You feel like the obstacle just comes and it just stops. It's like trying to move an immovable object. It just doesn't move. It doesn't want to move. It's tough. And so we waited and waited. Finally, the train starts to move. And then guess what happened? Another train from the opposite side comes in. We probably sat there for 30 or 40 minutes waiting to get through. And I believe that's what happens when we let obstacles get in our way of our faith with Christ. Sometimes we have obstacles that prevent us from really giving our attention and our time to God the way He wants it to be. This scripture passage from Luke this morning is really a great one. It talks about the day that Jesus went into this village and He finds a woman by the name of Martha who invites Him to come into her home. And what a hospitable person Martha must have been to invite Jesus in there. I think that's great. And Martha was really putting out a great dinner, I'm sure, for Jesus. I can just imagine roast beef, mashed potatoes and gravy, green beans, a little peach cobbler, you know. I can just picture iced tea, you know. There's a problem, though, because out of that scenario, Martha's sister, Mary, was also there. But Mary was nowhere to be found, and there was work to be done. Where was Mary? You know, we have a certain level of patience, don't we? I think a lot of us are given some patience, but it's like a layer. It goes through, And eventually we cut through all the patience and we just can't stand it anymore and we kind of blow up. Have you ever been there? You hope you get to that red zone where you know, uh-oh, I'm getting into the danger zone. And you can pull yourself back. Sometimes it's just like too late. I gotta say what's on my mind. And here's Martha now, sweating in the kitchen, either the hot stove's getting to her or the dishes. And she goes out and, where's Mary? What in the world? What happened to Mary? Well, Mary's sitting there listening to Jesus. What? There's work to be done. Somebody's got to do the dishes here. Mary, come on. So Mary just sits there, and finally Martha goes to Jesus and says, Lord, don't you even care that my sister is just sitting here and not helping me? And I like what Jesus said. You know what? Martha, you've got many worries and distractions, but there's only one thing that really matters. And Mary has found it. That's listening to the eternal words of God that I'm giving. Just being in my presence, that's enough. It's all we need. Distractions aside. Remember that movie called City Slickers? Some of you remember, and I showed a video of this a while back. There was a scene in that movie where these business executives from New York City, they go out to Wyoming, I think, into a dude ranch, and they're out there roughing it. And these guys have never even seen a horse, let alone touched a horse, let alone smelled a horse, let alone ridden on a horse. And they're out there roughing it for about a week, trying to find themselves, I guess, you know, trying to get this experience where they feel like, okay, I'm finding the direction to my life that I need to find. And the person that was their leader there that worked at that ranch, he was kind of a rough character, but he really gained all their respect. And there toward the end of the movie, I remember, I think it was Billy Crystal's character, he said, what's the secret? What's the secret of life? Remember, the gentleman points his finger up. What? And Billy Crystal goes, up? You know, what's he talking about? Well, he said, no, one thing. And then Billy Crystal says, well, what is that one thing? He says, that's for you to figure out. And today we have to figure out that one thing. What's most important in our life? And I believe Mary in this story, she had found out what the most important thing was, and that was to sit at the feet of Jesus. I was thinking about this story this week and how I believe most of us want to be with the Lord. We want to deepen our relationship with Christ. But we kind of treat Christ like we do a lot of things in life. That is, we'll get to Him when we get to Him. And that's me talking to myself as much as I'm talking to anybody. I'll make room and time for Jesus when I get done with all my chores. When I get my to-do list checked off. I hate to say this about myself, but I will. I'm kind of a person that will never relax until everything is done off my checklist. If I don't have it done, it's just sitting over me like this, tapping me on the shoulder. I can't even sit down and relax for 5 minutes until I get up and get everything done. But I was out taking a walk the other day, and it hit me like a ton of bricks. Here's the problem with that way of living. You never, ever will relax. You will never get to that point where everything is taken care of, because there will always be something that gets in your mind, into your world, into your routine, and you're going to feel like, I've got to take care of it. It's what an author said years ago, it's the tyranny of the urgent. Not what's important, but what's urgent. And typically what's important isn't always real urgent. We mistake those two. We take care of the urgent. We take care of the things that are clamoring for our attention rather than taking care of those things that really matter. The United Methodist Church, for all of the challenges that it has going on, they've got a lot of challenges, just like every church really does. Some are more evident than others. But I do like their mission statement. I really think it's a great one because it has to do with making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. That's what we're supposed to be about, is making disciples for Jesus Christ. And then the world, as a result, will be transformed. We cannot give that away, though, unless we have it to begin with. And I'm concerned for our church, for our individuals, for myself included, that it's just something we can just put off. We can be substituting being busy with being a disciple. And there's a big difference. There was a podcast I listened to this week. A gentleman was from North Carolina, and he was going to Guilford College about 50 years ago. And he talked about the day that he and his roommate first met, and his roommate was from New Jersey, and this gentleman was talking about his accent at that time. He said, "You think my accent now in North Carolina, you should have heard me back then." And then the guy from New Jersey was also there. Can you imagine? How can they even communicate? It's like they're talking two different languages. But I love what he said, because he said the day they moved in, his roommate from North Carolina or from New Jersey came down, and the mom and dad of his roommate had come and kind of gotten their son settled, and they were walking down the hall. The mom had gone down the hall, but the dad came back, and he said something to those students, and this gentleman said he never forgot it. The dad said, "Boys, let me give you one piece of advice. Don't let your classwork ever get in the way of your education. Don't let your classes get in the way of your real learning." And then this guy said, "You know, I look at it for the church. Don't let my church work get in the way of my discipleship." But how often do we get so enamored by things that have to be done? We are addressing those things that we think are so important. And there are things we want to do. I mean, I wrote things I'd like to see the churches do. But we have to be able to sit down at the feet of Jesus and let him speak to us and listen clearly to him. And that takes a lot of effort for some of us, more so than others. Some of us really struggle with just being calm and being quiet. There was a book that a student told me about back in about 1985. I was really blessed to work with some high school kids at Brookwood Covenant Church here in Topeka. And they were some really great young people who were, I think, just very extraordinary in their faith walk, even as 16, 17, 18-year-old kids. And some of them would tell me about different books, and I remember one they told me about was this one I'm holding in my hand right here. I don't think you ever saw this book. It's called When I Relax, I Feel Guilty. It was written by a gentleman named Tim Hansel. And there are some really great things in this book. And one of his main things is letting go of the things that just hold us back. Just let go of them. I was reminded of this myself yesterday morning. It must have been 2 or 3 in the morning. Sometimes I'll wake up at night and I can just go right back to sleep. And other times something gets in my mind and I just start chasing that thought. And I feel like I just ran a marathon by the time I'm done. I got to resolve that thought. And it may take me an hour, and I lost an hour of sleep. I don't think that thought came from the Lord. I think it came straight from the devil. I really do, because I don't think God is the author of confusion or anything other than just peace and comfort and rest. But that thought comes into my mind, and I chase it. And what hit me the other day was, next time that happens, I want to say, "Okay, Lord, you died on the cross for all these things that have got me all worked up, that are taking me away from you." Because when I'm chasing those thoughts, I'm not thinking about the Lord. Trust me, I'm thinking about how can I resolve this problem. Instead, "Lord, you take this. I'm going back to sleep. I'm going to let you handle this. I'll talk to you in the morning about it." Amen? But I think about these thoughts. And so now my goal, my prayer is, and I'll say, "Lord, you take that. You died on the cross for all my sins. You died on the cross for all my concerns and needs." It doesn't mean I'm putting my head in the sand and not dealing with issues. But I'm not going to deal with them at 2 o'clock in the morning. And when I do deal with them, I'm going to put Jesus Christ front and center. I'm going to deal with them the way he's guiding me to deal with them. Not the way I'm trying to deal with them, white knuckle. Like I'm driving an 18-wheeler down a mountain pass on an icy morning. That would be a trip, wouldn't it? I always thought of myself as a truck driver. Somehow I'd like to be a truck driver. But then again, I'm like, probably not. But I would really respect those guys. But you know, white knuckle is the way a lot of us live our lives. We are just so gripped onto that wheel. We're gonna steer it through no matter what. And God's got a better plan. It's to let go of our concerns, give them to Jesus, and let him take care of them. There's a poem here in this book I would like to share with you today that I think is kind of good. It sort of speaks to this. It has to do with how to break out of our routine. Before this poem, I want to read this. It says, "Let go of the need to constantly compare. Let go of some of the warm, comfortable, colorless, tasteless, abstract images you have of leisure, and leap out of some of your routines. Begin to refresh yourself in some of the simple joys of just being alive. Turn off your TV for a while and experience again the thrill of living your life directly rather than vicariously without all the baggage and parachutes. This is a poem written by an anonymous friar in a monastery in Nebraska late in his life. Listen to this poem. I really liked it. Haven't read this in years. It hit me when I was going over this week. I'll share it with you. He says, if I had my life to live over again, I'd try to make more mistakes next time. I would relax. I would limber up. I would be sillier than I have been on this trip. I know of very few things that I would take seriously. I would take more trips. I would be crazier. I would climb more mountains, swim more rivers, and watch more sunsets. I would do more walking and looking. I would eat more ice cream and less beans. That's the one line of that poem I've always remembered. I would have more actual troubles and fewer imaginary ones. I'm one of those people who lives life prophylactically and sensibly, hour after hour, day after day. Oh, I've had my moments. If I had to do it all over again, I'd have more of them. In fact, I try to have nothing else, just moments, one after another, instead of living so many years ahead each day. I've been one of those people who never goes anywhere without a thermometer, a hot water bottle, a gargle, a raincoat, aspirin, and a parachute. If I had to do it all over again, I would go places, do things, and travel lighter than I have. If I had my life to live over, I would start barefooted earlier in the summer and stay that way later in the fall. I'd play hooky more. I wouldn't make such good grades except by accident. I would ride on more merry-go-rounds. I would pick more daisies. I like that because I think that kind of gets at the heart of what I'm saying today. And I believe that as we look at this story of Mary and Martha, they realized that maybe it came to Martha a little later than Mary, but I believe they both realized who Jesus is here. He's the firstborn. He is the very Son of God right in their midst. Can you imagine how hard that would be to live? We have the luxury of 2,000 years to look back, but can you imagine how hard that would be at that time? This gentleman right here, this person is physically with us, flesh and blood. This is the Son of God. This is God wrapped up in human flesh, Jesus Christ. And to be able to take that leap sometimes, even when they had God right in front of them, Jesus in his flesh, sometimes he was taken for granted even by those who were the closest to him. I pray that as we go through our lives, our week, this week, that we would make the effort to not try harder, not do more for the Lord, but just to be in his presence, just to relax, to soak him up. I went out in the rain the other day. I thought, this is great. It's just, the guy was walking by me with a raincoat and an umbrella. I'm out walking with the shorts and a t-shirt. It wasn't a downpour. But you know, that's how some folks are going to live. I'm not knocking that guy. God bless him. He had places to go and things to do. But sometimes you just got to go out and feel that rain and soak it up. Sometimes you have to feel the love of Christ in a new way. Don't protect ourselves from all of the things that we're so concerned about. Trust him. He's got us under control. He loves us. He wants us to be with him. He wants that relationship that he created us to have. So recognize the distractions that are between us and God, first of all. Recognize them. Be aware of them. If something's not right between us and God, like we said, be aware of them. Second is develop the ability to relax. That is hard for some of us to do. Sometimes you've got to say, breathe. Just breathe. Just relax. Let everything go. And then third, once we've done that, spend time with Jesus every single day. Just sit at his feet, listen to him, let him speak to us. Let's just be a part of his life. Let him be a part of ours. Let him be the one that guides us every moment of every day. It's a choice that we have to make. I've got one last poem. Here, we're going to do some poems. This is my last one today. So this is also from this great book, When I Relax, I Feel Guilty. Slow me down, Lord. Ease the pounding of my heart by the quieting of my mind. Steady my hurried pace with a vision of the eternal reach of God. Give me, amid the confusion of the day, the calmness of the everlasting hills. Break the tensions of my nerves and muscles with the soothing music of the singing streams that live in my memory. Teach me the art of taking minute vacations, of slowing down to look at a flower, to chat with a friend, to pat a dog, to smile at a child, to read a few lines from a good book. Slow me down, Lord, and inspire me to send my roots deep into the soil of life's enduring values so that I may grow toward my greater destiny. Remind me each day that the race is not always to the swift, and that there is more to life than increasing its speed. Let me look upward to the towering oak and know that it grew great and strong because it grew slowly and well. That was by Orrin L. Crane. One last thought as we close. I was thinking this morning about the song called The Cat's in the Cradle. I'm giving you a lot of things that aren't necessarily in the Bible today, but bear with me because I think there's scriptural truth in all of these. And that was a song by Harry Chapin. He wrote it back in about, 72, 73. And it talked about a man who was really careful and concerned about his family. You remember the song, Cats in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, Little Boy Blue and the Man in the Moon?
Cat Stevens.
And then he goes, when you coming home, Dad? I don't know when. We'll get together then, son. We'll have a good time. And as the song goes on, you know what happened. The dad grows up, the son grows up. Next time the son comes to the dad, he says, hey, Dad, can I have the car keys, please? Dad realizes the window closed. He didn't spend time with his son. He let the tyranny of the urgent take over. And then finally the man retires and he says, I want to see if my son will let me come see him. It's, I got this time now. What a wonderful thing is time. He calls his son. He said, I'd love to, Dad, if I could just find the time, but my kid's got the flu and I've got things to do. But it's sure been nice talking to you, Dad. Sure been nice talking to you. And, the dad hangs up the phone. And it finally hits him. So my son was just like me. It dawned on me. My son was just like me. We've been given a gift of today, but let's take advantage of it. Let's don't rush through it. And say, there's another day off the list. Eventually we'll get to Jesus. Let's get to Jesus today. Let's give him the first fruit. Let's give him the best of what he has given to us. And he will bless us if we do that. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the reminder of what's important. And so often it's not what seems to be so urgent that we are getting the dishes done or getting the car done or thinking about all the things going on in the world around us, or our family concerns, our jobs, or whatever, Lord. Just help us to put those aside so we can spend time with your feet. And Lord, we know that's where you want us to be, so we can be with you in that fellowship and that relationship, so we don't have distractions getting in the way, that we have that wonderful friendship with you. We ask you would bless us in that area, especially as we go forth this week. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, we have another song, page 359. At the cross, where I first saw the light, page 359. Spirit as well. We'll do this in unison.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
If you're able, could you stand as we finish off our service with a great song of rousing victory in Jesus, page 370. Thank all of you for being here. So good to look out and see everybody here today.
God bless you this week as you go out. Give Jesus a little bit of time each day. You'll find out you're just going to want to spend more and more time with him. He is a friend like no other. Amen. So now hear the benediction. Lord bless you. Lord keep you. Lord make his face to shine upon you. Be gracious unto you. And Lord lift up his countenance on each and every one of you and give you his peace and his rest. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.